your father's crying.
Richard Carter Jr. comes to Elmwood Cemetery about once a month to visit the grave of his father, the drug kingpin, Maserati Rick, who ran a multi-million dollar crack cocaine and heroin empire on Detroit's east side. Maserati Rick was known across the country for driving flashy cars, wearing the finest clothes, and the most expensive jewelry, even hanging out with celebrities. So it's ironic that he has such a plain-looking grave marker for a man who police say amassed millions of dollars. It's even more ironic when you consider that underneath this simple headstone is this, a $16,000 silver coffin built like a Mercedes-Benz, complete with spinning wheels.
Most people know your dad as one of Detroit's most notorious drug dealers.
Okay, yeah, that's one part, but it's another part, the, you know what I'm saying, how he did good deeds for everybody, you know what I'm saying? You can ask people in the city how he helped people open up their businesses and just giving out money to whoever, if they needed it. Mm-hmm. So they ain't really cover that part of it, you know what I'm saying, his life.
The Maserati Rick in the headlines was infamous for running such a lucrative drug network and being the target of both local and federal authorities.
All this was in the Detroit Almanac.
So now, Rick Jr. is on a crusade to tell what he calls a more complete story of not Maserati Rick, but Richard Carter Sr., husband, father, and humanitarian. He's kept dozens of articles and artifacts, even his father's glasses and other items. He says it makes him angry to read only about what the police and FBI thought of his dad. That's why Rick Jr. has teamed up with the filmmaker and producer to dig into what we did not read in the paper. The two started this project last year, chronicling Rick Sr.'s other impact on the community.
The Maserati Rick story is very, very interesting.
Flip Wilson has written, shot, and edited 8 documentaries, some about a world that few of us have seen, like prison, drug users, and gangs.
Yo, lock them up in the basement and tie them up, you know?
And now this, an inside look and one of Detroit's most powerful drug dealers.
We've been working on it for like 6 months now, and we found out so many things that are false about the stuff that the news, press, and, you know, the street guys are saying, and it's just becoming so intense to research his life.
What do you want people to know about your dad? What do you think is the biggest misconception of him?
He wasn't like how everybody was trying to say he was, you know what I'm saying? Everybody liked him, smiled a lot. Everywhere he go, he smiled, so, you know what I'm saying? He got along with everybody. He had friends everywhere.
Maserati Rick had a legendary life, but he also had a legendary death. He was murdered here on the third floor of this hospital that's now Sinai Grace, but 20 years ago when it happened, it was Mount Carmel Hospital. He was recovering here in room 307 after having been shot by a drug rival. And then they came back on September 12th, 1988, to finish off the job. No one had ever been murdered inside that hospital, so security measures changed forever at the medical center on Detroit's west side.
This is my father and my mother.
The documentary will focus on things we did not know, like the fact that Maserati Rick wanted to be a boxer, so much so that there's a pair of boxing gloves on his tombstone.
To us, he's Maserati Rick, but to you, he's Dad. Are you proud of your father?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because it's like everything he did, he was trying to, you know, do this for the family.
Because his dad, as everybody knows, was in the tabloids, Jet Magazine. Everyone covered it in the 80s. So my main goal is to help him get some peace in the world to know the true Maserati Rick.
During the 1980s crack epidemic, Maserati Rick was one of the most recognized drug dealers in the city of Detroit. The flashy cars and exotic suits, and even his public death, made him an urban legend. Rick and his childhood friend, Demetrius Holloway, began their rise to fame in 1977 after the Fed started to bring down the infamous YBI gang for drug conspiracy and murder charges.
Maserati Rick was a good buddy of Demetrius's, but he was almost the polar opposite of Demetrius Holloway. Meech was a generous guy, you know, I think anybody that knew him. Rick, you know, if he told me it was raining outside, I might make plans to play golf. If he told me it was sunny, I'd probably go get my umbrella. He was just a different kind of guy.
Beside the lifelong association with Carter, it was alleged that Holloway was also close with James Red Freeman and this man, Big Frank Nitti Usher of the Murder Row gang.
Big Frank Nitti Usher was kind of an 80s gangster in the 70s.
Now, it was alleged that Holloway learned the heroin importation business from the Murder Row gang. Murder Row was known to run a lucrative drug business from Amsterdam into New York and back to Detroit in the late 70s. Authorities believe that Holloway, being a few years older than Carter, was the mastermind behind what they say was Detroit's largest multi-million dollar drug operation. Before he was Maserati, a young man named Rick grew up three doors down from boxing champion Thomas the Hitman Hearns. In those days, the east side of Detroit was known to breed hustlers, and little Rick Carter paid close attention, helping him get off to an early start.
Rick was always a hustler, and I remember like at the age of like 12, 13 years old, he used to go around the alleys picking up junk, taking it to the junkyards. He was always a hustler.
He worked at a liquor store called Old Queens. He used to be on Harper and Van Dyke.
My mother would tell him, wash dishes, because he'll want to go to a house party, one of those 50-cent house parties, and she'd be like, no, go do them damn dishes. But Rick would be like, here go $20, ma, and Paul Gray go in there do the dishes, and shit, Rick go on hanging out.
Rick took advantage of growing up with people like the Hitman Hearns. While other kids were at Skateland enjoying their childhood, Rick was already driven by money and got his first job as a towel boy at the Crunk Gym.
We all grew up together. We lived on the street from Thomas Hearns when we was little kids. And that's how I got started boxing. You know, being around with Rick and Tommy and Thomas' little brothers. We used to box down in Tommy Hearns' basement.
He hooked up with Thomas Hearns and became his towel boy, and that's when Rick started plugging in with a lot of different people.
At age 18, Rick's life started to transform. It was in this neighborhood, on Detroit's east side near City Airport, that he met a group of guys that introduced him to stealing cars. And after that taste of the streets, Rick's dream of being a fighter was put on hold.
All that shit, talking about in 82 he started selling drugs, all that shit lies. He started selling drugs like in 83, 84. He was stealing cars from 77 to 82.
Me and Maserati Rick and Greg Carter, we used to all get together, steal cars and everything.
He bought his first Benz on stealing cars.
Rick liked the Mercedes, and his first Mercedes that he got was a pile of blue Mercedes drop top, you dig?
You know, when they say chop shops and things like that, the insurance companies, they lose millions of dollars a year on, you know, chop shops, stealing cars and who's stealing cars.
He would blow the horn for me. My mom said, boy, your friend out here in that old pretty car. I run downstairs, me and him would go ride around, hang out.
Rick was just a cat, like I told you, stole cars and, you know, was a ladies' man, you know?
He was such a handsome man, and he used to wear this fur jacket that I just loved. I used to always ask to wear it.
I think originally he was known as Pretty Ricky, because he thought very highly of his looks.
I always wanted to be like Rick also. You know, everything he did, I tried, but I always went to jail or some old dumb shit, you know what I'm saying?
In 1978, Rick seemed to have it all figured out. He was stealing cars and good at it, and at the age of 18, he bought his first Mercedes-Benz. A year later, he would go on to meet his wife.
He met his wife, he was like 19. She was working at a McDonald's or something like that. Shit, next thing I know, we ain't know the nigga was married until about, shit, 2 years. They was married, we ain't know nothing about it, you know what I'm saying? We ain't really know he was married till his daughter was born, you know what I'm saying? His first child.
While Rick sat back and enjoyed his family life, his childhood friend Demetrius had other plans. After working briefly as a postal clerk on the east side in 1979, he was convicted of interstate transportation of stolen goods. And by 1980, he was sent to a federal prison in Chicago, Illinois.
When Demetrius Holloway went to jail.
East side was definitely like the Wild West, you know, it was like being in Vietnam, almost like a third world country in terms of the kind of violence that was taking place on a day in, day out basis.
Why do you think so many people are getting killed?
From drugs.
Today, crack cocaine use here is an epidemic, up 200% in the last year.
The configurations were much looser and more flexible, and it was hard for the media and for the police to kind of get a grip on it.
A lot of people became famous around that time, you know.
Back in our era, gangs was a big thing. At some point, though, as the 80s came in, gangs started to dissipate with the way as drugs grew bigger and bigger.
I think between 1980 and 1984, the price of a kilo of cocaine dropped, you know, from like $45,000 to like $17,000.
Detroit drug raids increasingly turn up teenage dealers as crack becomes the drug that makes some youngsters high and others temporarily wealthy.
I always know one day I'm coming here, United States.
Guess when Scarface come out, it made it real popular.
There's only one thing that gets orders and gets orders, and this is it.
When you start feeding people these images, you know what I'm saying? And it's like, you know, it's a groove. Then they build them character off of those movies. And guess what happened? We had a whole lot of Scarfaces, and we had a lot of New Jack City.
And in that, you had a lot of people using the drug, and Detroit's a big city, not just Detroit, but the suburbs as well. And I think that you had a lot of groups that were making so much money that they didn't want to take over an entire city. They were confident with the sections that they had.
By 1984, crack cocaine was everywhere in the city of Detroit. This new cocaine base was cheap and gave an explosive high at a time when Detroit already had horrible economic problems. Now, authorities had no idea what was going on right under their noses until teenagers all over the city started showing up with designer clothes and gold rope chains.
In the 1980s, local guys from Rick's East Side neighborhood quickly began to move up the ranks. Rick sat back for a couple of years, but eventually seized the opportunity to make more money selling narcotics than stealing cars.
The drug dealers on the streets, they kind of stood out.
You know, whatever it was, you wanted the best.
They was either trying to drive flashy cars, or the younger ones, they would walk around with a bundle of money.
During that era and during that time, anybody can pick up some drugs and become who they wanted to be, you know, or who they thought they wanted to be.
By 1982, Maserati Rick's operation had took off, allowing him to spend and live lavishly.
When he came in the door, you knew it was going to be something.
Yeah, he took us to City Slicker, Northland, you know what I'm saying, Fairlane, Somerset Mall, you know, buying Gucci this, Gucci that, you know, feeling this.
What kind of clothes did he like?
Well, he just did the shoe part of it. You know, he bought alligators, you know, all the colors and stuff like that.
One time he had an elephant head. It was, you know, nice size elephant head. He just flooded with diamonds.
So he just do things, you know, a little bit over the edge. You know, if there was one guy in here and bought one pair, he'd have to buy four or five. You know, but it's that kind of, you know, kind of story in here, you know. And when he came in, he just kicked it up a notch.
He was a big fan of Mercedes, so even though he was nicknamed Maserati Rick, he was known to drive like, you know, 10 or 15 different types of Mercedes.
He bought him a Benz, he bought his boy a matching Benz just like it, same color and everything.
That boy would get tickets to some of anything in this city, and he would call me and say, hey, Sonny Bono, man, you want to go to this, you want to go to this? And I'd be like, man, I ain't got no money, man, I'm straight, look. You ain't never need no money with me, man. You'll never need no money with me. If you want to go, let me know you want to go, and we out of here.
He just shared his money and shit, you know what I'm saying? You know, nothing to say about how he spent his money.
You know, the freshest of the freshest niggas, the best of the dope dealers, all come from the 80s. Not the 80s babies, the 70s babies that made the 80s what it was.
Now, it wasn't long before Rick started investing his money. He purchased several mansions in the suburbs, even a $1 million condo on Detroit's riverfront. It was reported that he invested millions of dollars in local businesses, such as car washes, hair salons, and even some local restaurants. Rick's business was just his front for his main job, the Kilo Man. The shops just served as laundering spots for all of his operations.
I worked at his car wash 12 years old. $50 was a lot to me at 12. So hey, I'm 32, and nowadays I'm be having $50. When I was living on days back then, yeah.
After 3 short years in the drug trade, Maserati Rick controlled most of the east side of Detroit. Investigators and close friends called Maserati the Kilo Man, which meant he only dealt with quantities. Maserati had become a major player to Detroit's underworld, meaning if you had cocaine in those days, chances were it came from Rick. The year 1985 was the magic year for the Kilo Man. His childhood friend and alleged business partner, Demetrius Holloway, got released from prison after serving a 5-year sentence.
He came out in around 85 and kind of took what he learned under Morton and Usher and became a real savvy businessman kind of in the drug market.
Then when Demetrius came home, and it just went on from there.
6 months after Holloway got out, he acquired a pool hall on West 7 Mile Road. Authorities say this pool hall would later become the beginning of Holloway's illegal alibis for his money laundering.
Demetrius was kind of in the background and more reserved, probably the more cagey and intelligent crime lords, you know, the city of Detroit's ever seen. He wasn't someone to cross and someone that would be quick to use violence if necessary, and he did.
A new face would emerge in 1985, the teenage attraction Richard Wersch, aka White Boy Rick. Despite the fact he was white and only 15 years old at the time, he won the respect of Carter and Holloway, who were both notorious by this time.
This is a prepaid debit call from
Rick.
This call is subject to monitoring and recording. Thank you for using Embark.
Hey.
What up?
You know, in the beginning, me and him fell out. And then we became cool because he used to mess with my son's mother. And he told me one day, he was like, I said, D, he was like, man, he used to look out for me, you know what I'm saying, if I wanted something after we got cool or whatever. And he was like, yo, I got $10 million put up out of state. He said, I don't even touch it. Bro, that was dope back then. Wasn't born for no bullshit.
Demetrius.
Yeah.
And he was over Rick, and didn't he, you told me he took all his cars and shit.
Man, he used to take all types of shit from Rick. Rick and them were scared to death of D, man.
Straight up.
By 1986, federal authorities alleged that Holloway, along with Carter, were running a multi-million dollar drug empire, which allowed Demetrius to open 3 sporting goods stores, in addition to purchasing several acres of land in Alabama. He also opened a company called Renter's Paradise to oversee several of his apartment buildings, which he had downtown.
He had a store, a sporting goods store, on 7 Mile just west of Evergreen. He had it for a couple of years and had an accountant, paid taxes, paid a lot of taxes.
With millions of dollars rushing in from heroin and cocaine sales, drug lords were scrambling for places to hide their money. Carter understood the street thug very well, to the point that he knew some of them had gone on to be police officers and that not all police officers abide by the law. So if he hired some of them, he would actually cut down on the amount of people who were investigating him.
Man, you gotta understand, D and them had like whole police force working for them.
And that's saying something. So how much drugs was really sold within the city? How much corruption was really done within the city?
You can't even imagine the power D had, man. Bro, he was claiming damn near $1 million on his taxes, bro. Legally.
Damn.
You know, that tells you the money he had. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's that.
Everybody says, like, Rick and them selling a lot of coke and all that. They were. But the money came from the heroin, bro.
They sold heroin, too?
That's where... Bro, Demetrius, you know where Mac and Gray is?
Yeah.
Demetrius owned the whole Mac and Gray. You know that, right?
No, I didn't know that.
Both sides of the street, he bought the whole, both apartment buildings. He would buy one key of China White, mix it up, buy it for $1.80, and get a mill off of it.
Straight up.
Yeah.
It's a lot of guys in Chicago and L.A. and New York that couldn't touch him.
I used to see Rick, and it was just amazed me that I would see him between the same hours every night. And most of the time when I see him, he's on the phone. I had no idea until later he would be in there getting things in order and conducting business or however it may be via the phone. Because back then, and out there in time, we didn't have cell phones. It was pagers.
Rick was more like a robot. He never slept. He was always on the go. It was always about going and get that money, going and get that money. The only thing I ever had to do was go to the gym, go to school, and run a car wash. And make a phone call, say, Rick, I need you. He said, meet me here. I mean, those was the days. The day I got to get out and bust my ass.
He's the youngest black guy in Detroit with a Maserati. The only black guy in Detroit with a Maserati. So that's when he got his name from.
You know, everybody wanted to get the next best thing, whatever it was, whether it be vehicle, home, or jewelry, whatever it was. You know, everybody was striving for the same destiny.
Holloway and Carter weren't the only ones controlling the streets. At the time, the East Side was home to many more infamous drug organizations.
Demetrius and Maserati Rick were one organization. Boy Boy Rick, where she was one organization that spawned off from the Curry Brothers organization. Big Ed Hansard was one organization. A group called the 2020 Club was an organization ran by Jimmy Bruiser Denard and Kevin Hollywood Duplessis. So you kind of had all these separate organizations. If one group was short, you know, his connection was slow for the month or for a couple months, they could go to an opposing group and you know, they would supply them, which is, you know, very rare. So you had, you know, the best friends, when they did become a drug gang, they were getting supplied by Demetrius, or if their connect wasn't good, they'd get drugs from Demetrius, or they'd get drugs from another crew.
They would continue to trade cocaine with one another for several years with no problems, until greed took over.
Oh man, Big Ed was that's like Joe Pesci. You know what I'm saying? That's like Tim Raw. You know what I'm saying? Niggas know about the mobsters and shit, you know what I'm saying? He's like a strong arm, but he just don't do strong. He making money too.
He had everybody up under him, you know.
He was not buying it. When Big Ed come your way, sure, this either get down or lay down.
Drugs grew bigger and bigger because everybody started getting greedy. And every man for himself.
By 1987, Big Ed and Maserati Rick had become impaled in a bitter battle in which the cause is still not known.
What I understand, some of the beef that Ed had arose from him going to get a connection in California that other people didn't have, that he wasn't going through some of his connections from Detroit.
However it started, it would spark one of the most violent street wars in Detroit's history. Carter used his fortunes to assemble a squad of killers, which would gain notoriety as one of the most efficient killing machines ever. Headed by Rockin' Reg, the Brown Gang, under the name Best Friends, was allegedly responsible for over 100 murders.
That's like a bunch of Big Eds. You know what I'm saying?
The Best Friends was specifically the Brown Brothers. And the four Brown Brothers were Reginald, Rockin' Reggie Brown, Terrence Boogaloo Brown, Gregory Ghost Brown, and Ezra Wizard Brown. The media's perpetrated over the years is that the Best Friends was this kind of giant conglomerate of a lot of the names that populated the newspapers and popped up on the television screens. They were all real close, and I guess the legend has it that the Best Friends came from the fact that when people saw them coming, they'd be like, oh, all those Best Friends, those guys are all coming to town, coming to this club, coming to this spot, or coming to this part of the city, and they kind of just became known as the Best Friends.
The whole Best Friend crew was like a bodyguard just for them too.
I didn't hung with them niggas a couple times at the mall, and you know, I sort of kind of on my shit. At the same time, like, these niggas ain't no hoe. But come on, these my niggas, I'm fucking with them. So shit, you know, I'm cool. I'm probably about the safest nigga in the world at that point. But anybody else, oh, you catch it. What the fuck you looking at? And you catch it.
There was so much money floating. When they figured out that they can actually rob the dope boys and get away with it, was when they seem like, man, this is where we make our money now.
They can make some you know, nice change, you know, putting hits on people and being an enforcement crew or murder for hire crew, but they can make a lot more money if they got their own connection.
Motherfucker got burned up, torched and shit, you know, right behind the building, a lot of motherfucking dead bodies and shit.
And they would actually know the guys they was going after.
When you started having 7-8 people killed in a house, at that time, the community was outraged because these was young black men.
And when I say literally robbery, I mean they not just come in your house because, you know, gun. Guys then give you some gunplay. Now you gonna run in there, but you gonna throw some bullets. So it's gonna draw a whole lot of other attention. So a lot of times they pick and choose a time or a situation when they would actually try to rob guys.
With the gangster shit, you know, bad shit got to happen. And some niggas is more bred up on the bad shit than having the good shit.
Police Benevolent Association has warned that the criminal justice system can no longer protect the public and urge people to arm themselves.
The police are telling people to come in here and buy guns, and they are in alarming rate.
During the Bloody Street Wars, allies were lost, but none closer to Rockin' Reg than the loss of his youngest brothers, Ezra and Gregory, which happened within a week of one another. The death of Ezra and Gregory did nothing to deter the two remaining brothers from killing anyone that stood in their way. In fact, it just seemed to light the fire that would rage out of control for the next several years. Despite having problems with Carter and his associates, Big Ed's business skyrocketed. By 1987, he was deemed a major competitor. LAPD officers spotted him and several of his contacts cruising the Sunset Strip while they flashed their Mercedes and brand new Porsches until they were pulled over. Big Ed would be jailed for having several illegal IDs in his possession, as well as $300,000 cash separated into $5,000 bundles.
He was flashy, like I say, majority of the people in that era was flashy at that time. Wasn't nothing wrong with standing out. People had balls and guts to make money.
No charges were brought about, but the episode marked the arrival of Big Ed Hazard as a mover and shaker on a national scale. Following his return to Detroit, authorities say Big Ed was attacked by Maserati and his goons with automatic weapons. In spite of being wounded in the stomach during the attack, which took him out of the game for months, Big Ed refused to identify Carter as one of the perpetrators and said he would choose to take care of the issue himself. Authorities believe that Maserati Rick would try three more times to kill the troublesome Hazard without success. Carter's failed attempts to eliminate Hazard would soon prove to be a fatal mistake. May 20th, 1988, the leader of Best Friends, Rockin' Reg, got sentenced to life in prison. The life sentence of one of the Brown brothers would rob the gang of their most intimidating enforcer, which signaled a weakening to all of Carter's enemies. It wasn't long before Hazard responded to the attempts on his life by organizing a fleet of drive-by shootings. Allegedly, Hazard drove by Rick's mother's house and unloaded a fully automatic weapon while she was on the porch holding little Rick, who was only 2 years old.
We shot up my mother's house, and his girlfriend's mother's house.
Unsuccessful, Hazard would try again 2 months later. This time, he allegedly tried the home of Little Rick's mom, but he got distracted and fired shots into the neighbor's house, resulting in his arrest.
Like a month later, I see the same guy in jail, and he had like 3-4 guys on his jock, and I'm like, damn. But me not hanging out with her, they didn't know who I was, but when they was talking about the BMW being flipped over when the police was chasing them, I knew exactly who they was. I wanted to do something to him, but there's nothing I could do at the time, so I just let it go. But at that moment, it had taught me to watch what I say around people that I really don't know, because you never know who you're around.
Soon after Ed got out, it was reported that he put a note on Rick's car stating, "I'm going to get you, and if I don't, my son will grow up and finish the job." On September 10th, 1988, outside of Rick's car wash on West 7 Mile Road, Big Ed finally got his wish. As Carter pulled out of the car wash, he was thrown into an unexpected gun battle, leaving an alleged associate of Ed shot in an arm and Rick with a blow to the stomach.
A family member who did not want to appear on camera said Carter was shot on Friday while washing his car. She said she spoke to him this morning on the telephone, and he said he couldn't identify who shot him.
Then it was actually a jungle that he was stepping into, and he didn't really realize and didn't know just exactly how deep he got himself into.
All thing he wanted was his money back. You know, he ain't trying to, he ain't really wanting to hurt nobody. It's business. It's not nothing personal. It's all business.
How did you end up getting shot outside of the Rick's car wash back then?
Well, he caught me. That's how I got shot. He shot me accidentally. It was bad. I got hit. And that's left accident.
He was a passive gentleman. You know what I mean? He wasn't the kind of guy, man. But that lifestyle will suck you up and make you think that you're something that you're not. You know what I mean?
No matter how many people Maserati Rick supplied, it didn't change the way his enemies viewed him. In fact, 2 days later, a man was able to enter room 307 at Mark Carmel Hospital where Rick was recovering and pump several shots into the head of the keeper.
Hospital officials say 29-year-old Richard Carter of Northwest Detroit didn't make it this time. Officials say two men were seen near his room when the shooting was discovered.
Really, we don't have a whole lot of details other than the fact that some people saw two men. Anybody can visit patients, and there was no restrictions on visiting this patient. There are sometimes restrictions imposed by patients or the police department, et cetera, and there were no restrictions on this patient.
This is the first time in the hospital's 50-year history there has been a shooting inside. Officials say after today, they plan to reevaluate their security measures.
Is it true the day of Rick's murder, you were picked up outside the hospital wearing a police uniform?
I don't like dressing up here nowadays, you know what I'm saying? Disguise. You know what I'm saying? I like mingling. You know what I'm saying? I think I was going to a party. You know what I'm saying? You got always got to be. That's how you do things. Nobody really know me.
News of the shooting upset visitors who came to the hospital located at Outer Drive and Schaefer Road. They were banned from visiting patients on the third floor for the rest of the night.
How, what, who, or should we know? Because where's security? How does that happen?
All this, how they got into it and all that stuff, mm-hmm. I don't care. It don't really matter to me.
Do you, to us, he's Maserati Rick, but to you, he's Dad. Are you proud of your father?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What do you regret most about him not having been here? Just knowing him,
knowing
part of his life, or?
Everything.
Yeah.
But it's like, you know what I'm saying? I can't really be mad at that. It took me a long time to, like, accept it, but I did.
Rick died at an early age. And a lot of people, you know, ask me, do I really feel bad? Yeah, I miss him, but it's like, only thing I think he will regret is not seeing his children grow up and seeing his grandkids. That's the only regret I think he would have today. But other than that, Rick had a great life. And he did whatever he wanted to do, when he wanted to do it, and it was like, shit. If he was here today, Kwame Kilpatrick would probably be working for him.
But regardless of all that, I remember Rick being pretty much alone. And I like that about him, because he was cool people. No matter what went on, what you heard, this is a guy that walked the streets by himself. He was just a real likable and lovable guy. It was just cool, regardless to what you heard or what you seen.
Now tell me about your shirt. What is this?
This is my father and my mother. Like in, I guess it's probably like 1985. I don't know where they was going, but yeah.
We used to box down in Tommy Harney's basement, and Rick was ready to open up his own stable of fighters, and we'll go start fighting down out of the 20 grand. But unfortunately, he got killed before this happened. But, you know, after that happened, I just kind of just quit fighting because at that time, Rick was my higher power. He was my God.
Hours after, Hazard provided an alibi for the brazen murder. When questioned by authorities, Big Ed denied any knowledge that the killing even took place, but did admit to throwing a brick through the window of Rick's car wash a week earlier.
They were good friends. You know, whatever happened between them at that time and phase, that's only them. That's between them, and they only know.
They loved each other, man, like brothers, straight up brothers, man. But I got my suspicions, man, you know what I'm saying? It's just a couple people I really don't believe that they really love him, you know what I'm saying?
He didn't have a whole lot of enemies. I only could think of maybe one at the time. And he didn't want me hanging out with him because of, you know, just not to be doing it. It was just protecting his little brother. And like I say, I thank God for that, I thank Rick for that, and I love him very much.
They did what they did. People was hating, but it's good though. He was the uncle I knew for 12 years of my life. I mean, haters took him out. I mean, it's nothing. Our family's still going on. I mean, yeah, it hurt him when they took him away from us, but I mean, it's nothing. Like I say, we still living on. He was a legend like everybody was a legend, but he was that uncle that looked out for his family.
The next day, police would announce their prime suspect, this man, Lodrick Parker. An alleged associate of Big Ed, Parker was fast establishing himself as the single most dangerous man on the east side.
You know what I'm saying? Like, Rick, you know what I'm saying? Hey, that one, shit, they better not disappear. You know what I'm saying? Everything shooting up, what are you doing? Who knows? Me, Rick, and me, one, two other people. You know what I'm saying? They can say, they know, but other than that, nobody. Clear of charge of that, you know what I'm saying? Like a lot of murder cases I've been, you know what I'm saying, shot at me, you know what I'm saying? Who want me to plead guilty to? Nobody can say I need it but me.
Parker would be tried and acquitted of Maserati Rick's murder, but just 10 days later after his acquittal, authorities say Parker shot into a home they believe belonged to Demetrius Holloway, though he wasn't home during the attack.
They don't have proof of that. Like OJ. Maybe it's OJ killed, you know what I'm saying, the two. You know what I'm saying?
We all know what happened back then, so I don't want to even talk about that no more.
Maserati Rick had a legendary life, but he also had a legendary death.
He went out like a straight-up soldier, you know what I'm saying?
Maserati Rick's lifestyle will live on even after his death, as his family and close friends bought the most expensive mortuary surgeon in Detroit at the time. After graduating at the top of his class at Warsham College of Mortuary Science, this man, Idle Richardson, came to Detroit in 1987 to make a name for himself.
Yeah. Out of I've been embalming for 62 years. Actually, this is my 62nd year of doing the work. I had to do, some restorative work on him. But
how'd you do that?
Huh? But no one, you
super
know.
Super job.
Everyone coming out, they wanted to see the marking on him. They couldn't see any, so they were disappointed, you know. It was quite
entertaining.
Yeah.
Perhaps the most entertaining moment of Maserati's life was his funeral. Six of the most powerful men on the east side rolled him down the church aisle in a Mercedes-Benz casket, complete with gold rims and working headlights.
And when we bought the casket, then it was custom made, you know, the wheels and everything, and had the grill and the bumper, and all of this was, you know, it was custom made. See the grill in the front there?
That casket said it all, fool. And I'm on here at camera telling it all. Ball of status is what he lived. He went out the right way. He was done the right way. So, I mean, everybody all, oh, he was in a casket with wheels. I mean, if that was his lifestyle, that was him. That was his status. So don't hate, you know. Big time, you feel me? That's what he was. So don't hate on my uncle because he was in a casket. Most people paid 4 G's. He was in a casket. It was 25. So holler at that.
The $20,000 coffin back in 1980. So, definitely went out in style.
He made his money, you know, he lived his life, and I guess he went out, like I said, like he lived. Flashy, you know, he went out like he lived, you know, so that's an A+.
When you saw the pictures, because you were how old? You were 2?
Yeah, it was my birthday, September 18th, so it was like 6 days before my birthday, you know. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Did you, when you look back at those pictures of, you know, that casket, what goes through your mind? Because that's like a legendary. Everybody.
It's like I always knew about it, so it really wasn't that. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, yeah, I know. But to other people, it's like.
Like, wow.
It's bigger than life, you know what I'm saying? But to me, it's like, that's what's up. Don King, Tommy Hines.
Wow. After the funeral, Holloway was picked up and questioned by authorities. While being questioned about his finances and his connection to Maserati Rick, Holloway denied any involvement in drugs. However, he did state that he was a successful and legitimate gambler who frequently visits Las Vegas and Atlantic City. And he claimed to file taxes on his earnings.
No one could say he wasn't a gambler. I mean, he had receipts and losses from the casinos in Vegas and Atlantic City. This was before there were casinos here. I mean, he was a huge gambler.
Several months after being harassed, Holloway would disappear at the Top Hat hamburger stand on Gratiot and Ford Freeway. Witnesses describe a blast of gunfire and squealing tires while a man's body was tossed in a trunk.
He was smart enough when the heat got too high, he organized his own disappearance and faked a kidnapping.
He was always thinking, and the disappearance, which it turned out to be, of course, was staged as a murder. And I don't think I ever believed he was murdered. I didn't know for sure until I got a phone call saying that this is the dead calling you. And in those days, this is before cell phones and numbers popping up, I just got a phone call in the office, and I picked up the phone and said hello, and it was Meech. I mean, I knew it was him, and he says, "This is the dead," and I just started laughing.
Meanwhile, best friend Rockin' Reg made a shocking return when he managed to have his murder conviction overturned. He won his appeal in February of 1989 when he was released on personal bond to the city's probation department. Brown returned to the streets and immediately tried to take control of Detroit's underworld. While Reg was gone, his younger brother Terrence had undergone a transformation. He turned up the heat and was now feared almost as much as his brother. Reg wasted no time reuniting with his younger brother. They designed a plan to climb the ladder in the drug world. 2 days after Reg's release, it was alleged that the Brown brothers went on a murder spree.
Murders in November alone.
And the trend is up. Fed authorities say by all-out warfare among drug dealers.
It's robbing, sticking up, and getting their money too.
You can't ruin no street because it ain't like that. It's gonna be like this. Anybody come along, you see a bullet, you just gonna get hit with it. That's what happened today.
Bullet may be intended for a person, but who's ever in the way it just hit. That's all it is.
Drugs and guns are a deadly mixture, and together they've given Detroit the highest murder rate of any American city.
Bodies, dope selling, dead bodies, motherfucker, weed selling, everything.
Authorities say there's an avalanche of cocaine crossing our borders.
But as hard drugs spread beyond the cities,
Authorities are being overwhelmed.
The murder rate by kids as young as 15 has doubled in the last 6 years, and by the year 2000, this epidemic of violence will only surge.
Whole neighborhoods are killing grounds. Many of the victims and their killers are very young, teenagers and younger. Now the schools not only have the traditional memorials to those who died in world wars, but new makeshift memorials to those who died in street wars.
So much death in the Oakland streets. Am I gonna live till next week?
A couple of months after the best friends were back on top, Maserati Rick's oldest brother, Clyde, would be gunned down. As they got out of the car with their one-year-old child, two gunmen rolled up and opened fire on the couple, killing him and his girlfriend, leaving the one-year-old child unharmed.
Somebody had came up right now when he was getting out of his truck, because at that time he had a red pickup truck, and took him out. And the next thing you know, it flashed on the news that Clyde had got killed, and his little child was left on his body, you know? And I guess that was a signal to let him know, you know what I mean? It was real talk, you know, when they killed him, you know?
See, my mom, Clyde, they live their life, they live their status. Everybody get it how they live, you feel me? I'ma keep it real. I ain't gonna be on here fake about nothing. He did what he did. Niggas hated and took him out, but what? They ain't did nothing off for real, they didn't, so.
After Ed and Parker went to prison and Rick's brother Clyde was murdered, Demetrius would once again surface. In October of 1990, he returned to Detroit. This would be Holloway's final visit to the city that he once controlled.
Holloway loved to shop. In fact, you would often find him here at the Broadway buying the best of clothes. His family and friends knew that, but so did his enemies. In fact, on October 8, 1990, some of those enemies showed up here and murdered him while he was shopping.
Police tonight refused to release the identity of the man found shot at the Broadway clothing store. But friends and relatives of Demetrius Holloway gathered quickly after word of the shooting spread through the city. This woman, who says she's Holloway's wife, could get little information. Officers questioned Holloway's brothers about whether he carried a pager and what he was wearing today.
Did he have anything like a blue jean or a type of suit or something? I guess what they call used or something.
They said the person there has on a two-piece used
blue jean suit.
Two men drove into the parking lot beside the Broadway about 3:30 this afternoon in a brand new BMW. They left the store a half hour later as police arrived to investigate a shooting inside.
They come running out and it was raining out. And I said, where's the key? Where's the key? I said, well, hold on a second, sir. I'll get you the key. No, I want the key right now.
Detroit police and federal agents are very familiar with Demetrius Holloway. He is one of the Drug Enforcement Agency's biggest local targets. He is right now the subject of a federal probe and a grand jury investigation. Agents have seized cars, houses, and sporting goods stores he owned, believing they are the proceeds of drug profits.
We are amassing a tremendous amount of evidence that I think will clearly implicate him in major drug movements within the city of Detroit.
If this is Holloway, this is the latest death in a bloody turf war being waged by the city's drug lords. At least three other alleged traffickers have been killed within the month. Holloway is a leader of the pack. If he is dead, there is expected to be some serious shuffling among the ranks.
This death has created a void that I'm certain will be rapidly filled by players in the city, and we're going to be watching that very carefully.
You know, it was one of the more brazen gangland murders in the history of the city. You know, broad daylight in a popular store. I don't think the guy was wearing a mask or anything. He just came up in the middle of the spot and just blew Demetrius up.
He was real tight, you know what I'm saying? Niggas had to get him like that because that was the only way you could get him, you know what I'm saying? His shit was real tight, you know? He was really going to be the number one man. He was the number one man.
The person that ordered it wanted it done in a specific way. And probably sent a message, and I think it definitely sent a message.
He was like a criminal-minded genius, but he also wasn't born for no bullshit.
Well, Demetrius Holloway was unique amongst clients, I will say this. He was very, very smart. He didn't drink. He didn't use drugs.
We ain't never 15, 16 now, man.
This boy would come to school every day suited up. You hear me? I never seen him in a pair of gym shoes. Never. And Demetrius would come. Even when we played in the gym, he have on his gaiters, man. Have on his gaiters and suspenders, man. You know, we playing in the gym.
He had $92,826 or something in the trunk of the car. And one way or another, the police, they stopped him for, they said, a traffic ticket. They knew it was him. The next thing you know, they were in the trunk of the car. We wound up in front of Judge Talbot in circuit court, and Demetrius got up there and testified about how he had won the money gambling, and it was his money. And I'll never forget, the judge turns to him and he says, "Well, Mr. Holloway, you know, what are you doing with $92,000+ in the trunk of your car?" And Demetrius turns to him and says, "Well, Judge, I thought this was America. I thought you could carry your money wherever you wanted, whenever you wanted, however you wanted." And even Judge Talbot had to pause and laugh at that one. It was a heck of an answer.
Demetrius Holloway, White Boy Rick, Maserati Rick, Big Ed Hansel, all them niggas, they held their own. I mean, it's kind of fucked up how some niggas had to clash, but you know what I'm saying? There only could be one top man, or only could be a few top men, and they got to work together.
Nearly a decade after Demetrius Holloway's murder, federal authorities named the Milton brothers as the hired gunmen who shot Holloway in the 1990 Broadway department store shooting. Lester Milton shot Holloway while his younger brother Thomas stood guard at the store entrance.
For most people, we can only spend so much of our money on wardrobe. But for drug lords, money was not an issue. In fact, on many occasions, they would show up at places like City Slicker and drop thousands of dollars at a time on shoes and expensive suits.
Look at the ending. Look at Scarface. What happened? You know, he did it. He started from scratch. He was a, what was he, fast food server, all right? And next thing you know, got the world, right? Get killed. What'd he do? Cross out his man, all right? You know, he was supposed to do something he didn't, called conflict. He wasn't ready, he killed him. See the end of New Jack City, look at that. Your man, Nino, turned rat. Follow what I'm saying? Same thing, man. You know, so those endings are true. See, so when you're looking at these movies and you're trying to actually live out this here, you know, there's a bigger picture and there's a message in that movie. And it's always the ending.
We getting it good, money good, everybody riding, everybody eating, you know what I'm saying? Everybody staying geared up. And I end up doing the unthinkable. I didn't see this one coming. I end up killing a man. I end up shooting a man right there on the corner of Frankfurt and Connors. And I ran up to the car. Me and the guy had a couple of words. What happened was he tried to pull my sister in the car. He tore a little shirt, tore a jacket. And I want to make this clear. I am truly sorry about killing another black man. Because even though he did what he did, it wasn't worth killing him. And it's painful me today because I realized that I didn't just kill him. I killed his mother. I killed his family. I killed his sisters and his brothers. And I live with that every day. So, you know, I want to make that clear that I am sorry. I am remorseful.
Nigga, don't believe that song.
Once upon a time in the Detroit city, there was a young big shot with knots 150s. He was known for whipping fancy cars and stacking ends. Matter of fact, his casket looked like a Mercedes Benz. He laundered his money through car washes and hair salons. Far from low budget, the dope game, upper echelon. Boss of all bosses, creme de la creme. Top dope man in Detroit, that was him. You had problems, his goons would definitely solve them. And fuck 28s, he dealt thousands, now that's volume. Half his crew to hit the other moves, packs and things. And if he had to, he know he made them rappers bang. Living lavish and niggas was hating. Made enough enemies to fill up Tiger Stadium. Gunfights, broad daylight, room 307, Sinai Brothers, that's where they killed him.
They shot him in his face.
Live fast, die young, make a pretty corpse.
Do it,
how you living, have fun. Cause when you're dead, you're dead.
My niggas is on the match.
Back of his head, back of his head, back of his head.